Hi again, it's Jason from Fraser Valley Rose Farm. I want to answer a question I get a lot from gardeners this time of year, which is why are the leaves of my plants turning white? Now the white they're talking about is like this, and I'm not sure if you can see this real close up, so I'll get a close up picture of it, but it's a white patches or white covering, sometimes fuzzy, on the upper surface of leaves, and it's actually fairly unmistakable. It's called powdery mildew, and there are some very susceptible plants. So if you see this and it's combined with a plant that I list here, pretty much it's confirmed it's powdery mildew. So let's talk about squash, we talk about cucumbers and melons, grapevines get it quite frequently. Also, my favorite, roses, they get powdery mildew fairly frequently. In perennials, you'll sometimes see it on phloxes and monardas and a host of other perennials as well. And sometimes you'll see it on broadleaf trees like this one here. This is a horse chestnut, but also we get it quite a lot on our local big leaf maple. So that's what it is, powdery mildew. And it's over a wide range of plants. Let me talk to you a little bit about how it spreads, what are the conditions, how you can try to prevent it, and how do you treat it if you have it on your plants. So I've just told you that your plant has a fungal infection on its leaves. I guess your next response should be to ask, how serious is that for the health of my plant? And the answer is, it varies an awful lot by the host variety, the host plant variety, and how severe that infection progresses to be. So on that tree that I have out there, and basically most healthy trees will never be set back too far by a powdery mildew infection. They'll come through it just fine. They're a long life cycle plant, and one season with powdery mildew on the leaves, or even every season with powdery mildew on the leaves, isn't going to set them back much. Likewise, on my roses, I have to say it's more of a small nuisance than anything else. I don't think any of my roses lives are being threatened by a powdery mildew infection. Most it's going to do is it's going to be a bit unsightly. It might reduce the flowering on my plants for one season if it gets particularly bad, but typically it does not impact the health of the plant significantly. Similarly with the perennials, the phloxes and monardas can get powdery mildew every year later in the season and still come back healthy the next spring. So the ones you really do have to concern yourself with a little bit more, unless it gets to be an out-of-hand infection, is things like the squashes, the cucumbers, the melons, zinnias, and grapes. Those things that you're trying to get a crop off of them. So you're trying to get the fruit or you're trying to get the flower from them, and they're fast growing, and their inability to get that sunlight through to those healthy leaves because powdery mildew is in the way and the health deteriorates in the plant means that your crop can be ruined dead stop. So that's where it's more serious, is usually in those short cycle annual crops or those ones you're trying to get an actual physical crop off of. Whereas for ornamental plants, it's usually a little bit less severe unless you're trying to sell them, which I do. So let's talk about how you prevent it. Now the truth is, it is a spore, it's a fungal spore, it travels in the air, it blows in from everywhere. You can't really stop it from coming into your greenhouse, even if I grow in a greenhouse like this. Closing the sides isn't going to keep it out. In fact, you're at a special risk in a greenhouse because humidity levels are up. So let's talk about the conditions that powdery mildew likes. It likes humid, wet on the leaves, and it's actually a little bit better in cooler or moderate temperature conditions. So early in the season in a greenhouse like this, you're very susceptible to powdery mildew, particularly on a cloudy day. That's when it's really going to bring up the high humidity inside the plants. Cooler temperatures, you're going to have the germination of those spores on your leaves. I will say one other thing is they sometimes tag team with aphids. So if you get a lot of aphids, a healthy plant may be resisting the germination of the fungal spores on the leaf surface. But once you get the aphids in there, they stick their little sucking parts into your leaves, and it leaves an opening for those for the powdery mildew to infect your plant. So they sometimes go hand in hand. All of those stresses sometimes go hand in hand. So any kind of a physical stress on your plants, either by underwatering or by aphids, can sometimes make them a little bit more susceptible to powdery mildew. All right, let's talk about prevention, because honestly, once there's a good covering of powdery mildew on your foliage, it's pretty hard to wipe it out. And your consideration for prevention should always start by looking at resistant varieties of plants. Let me give you an example in perennials. Monarda, or bee balm, is quite widely susceptible to powdery mildew, but there is one cultivar, one well-known cultivar, called Jacob Klein, which is a beautiful red one that actually holds off the powdery mildew, or at least doesn't get it until much, much later in the season, so you don't have to worry about it quite so much. Now in roses, there are a lot of the newer varieties that are much more powdery mildew resistant. You can go onto the site that I've recommended before, Help Me Find Roses, and that one will show you in the description whether the plants are resistant or not. This one here is a variety called Variegata de Bologna, which is a bourbon rose, unfortunately fairly susceptible to powdery mildew. I grow it anyway for historical purposes and because it has a beautiful flower, but I'm aware of that, and so I always watch it for the symptoms of powdery mildew early in the season. You will also see that in squash, cucumbers and melons, that oftentimes when you go to the seed catalogs, they will actually list in the name of the plant PMR, or powdery mildew resistant. And if they don't list it in that, then it's well worth reading into the description of the plant to make sure that it has good resistance to powdery mildew, because again, it may not be a case of avoiding the disease entirely, but if it can hold it off until the later part of the season, after you've already got your harvest in place, that's just as good, or almost as good. So I know I'm gonna have to talk about spraying here at some point, because spraying is the go-to when dealing with fungus, but give me a couple more minutes to talk about cultural controls here, the importance of which, the first of which, is to talk about good air circulation. In a greenhouse here, we manage that very carefully because we know that humidity can build up around those plants. So we install circulating fans to keep the air moving. Outdoors, you want to manage it with the same thing in mind. So don't plant your plants so tight together that there's no air circulation. Space them appropriately and prune them for good air circulation through the plants. I know this on roses, I teach this on roses, is to prune it to allow air to flow through the bottom edge of that plant so we don't get powdery mildew down low that then progresses up high in the plant. Also, let's talk about watering, feeding, and establishing your plants well. The healthier the plant, the less susceptible it is to powdery mildew, and particularly on roses, I will say that a lack of water will lead to powdery mildew and susceptible varieties every time. So that may sound paradoxical to you to talk about watering a plant well, but then also not letting the foliage stay too wet. Ways you can manage that: use drip irrigation or some other form of irrigation that keeps the water down low where it isn't getting onto the foliage. Or if you are using overhead irrigation, be a little strategic about it. If you see a sunny day with a bit of a breeze, water early in the day when it has plenty of time to evaporate off those leaves. That's good enough. All right, now let's talk about spraying, but I don't really encourage the heavy chemicals. Two reasons. First of all, I don't want to wear a spray suit. I don't want to expose my family and my farm to heavy chemicals. But the second thing I'll say is that the studies show that there are some less harmful solutions that are just as effective as the heavy chemicals. Two of those that you would use as directed on the bottle, so look for neem oil for horticultural use. That can do a good job. Also, wettable sulfur does a good job of reducing the incidence and severity of powdery mildew, usually again as a preventive early in the season, and both of those products are good in the cooler part of the season, not so great in the later part of the season when it's warmer, because they can be phytotoxic at higher temperatures. So a couple that I'm going to talk about here, I'm going to talk about a baking soda and oil spray that I've recommended before when it comes to black spot. I'm also going to talk about a milk spray. So the baking soda spray by recipe, and this time I'll give it to you in gallons, is if you had a gallon of water with 1 tablespoon of preferably potassium bicarbonate baking soda and say 3 tablespoons full of horticultural oil, or you can use canola oil as a substitute. Now the reason I say potassium bicarbonate preferably and also horticultural oil preferably is that these two ingredients are proven to be less phytotoxic. They don't burn the leaves quite as much. So if you do substitute them with canola oil or with sodium bicarbonate, go ahead and do so. Just, I would probably either cut back the recipe or dilute it slightly, or test it first so you don't see higher, you can see how much phytotoxicity there is. This, and again, in studies, that preparation has been shown to work as well as the heavier chemicals in reducing powdery mildew. The final one I'm going to talk about is milk. Now, milk does work, and the solution that I've seen mixed, again in the studies, is that it has to be at a fairly high rate, somewhere in the range of about one part milk to two parts water, or about a 33% solution of milk. You spray that on, preferably on a warm, hot day. It will smell really bad. It may leave an unattractive coating of its own on the foliage, but it does a good job of holding off powdery mildew. Only thing I would say about that is, in comparison to the oil and baking soda spray, it's probably a little more expensive to prepare and apply on a regular basis, and you do have to deal with the stink. So that's my conclusion on the spraying. All right, I hope this answered some of your questions on powdery mildew, and if you have any other questions on powdery mildew or other plant diseases, please drop those below the video.